but you're gonna get it now. God knows what you've done to that poor girl.
This is Agent Nightingale, FBI! Get him up, Hemingway! You're under arrest! You move a muscle, I'll unload right in your goddamn face! Stay right where you are, Slade!
What are you? I'm standing right here, you goddamn maniac!
I hated to leave Barry behind, but there was no way I'd miss my appointment with the kidnapper.
Give it up, Mr. Wake! Come on! Make it easy on him!
Don't let him get away! Move it!
For decades, the darkness that wore Barbara Jagger's skin slept fitfully in the dark place that was its home and prison. It was hungry and in pain. It dreamed of its nights of glory when the poet's writing had called it from the depths and given it a brief, terrible taste of power and freedom. The rock stars had stirred it from the deep sleep the poet had sunk it back to in the end. When it sensed the writer on the ferry, it opened its eyes. Rose didn't know how the strange old lady got in her trailer, and she looked wrong somehow. The woman showed her teeth in an approximation of a smile and traced a finger down Rose's cheek. "Pretty girl," she said. Rose felt as if she was falling asleep, but her knees didn't buckle. The crone spoke in a whisper, her words ice cold and dark in Rose's ear.
Thank you.
This horror was everywhere I went, circling me. The cops didn't stand a chance. They were after a writer, not a monster.
Thornton, come in. Over.
Thornton here. James, we got both Wheeler and Rose in custody. They didn't put up a fight or anything. Why, they were... Hey, Mulligan, what are you doing? Come on.
Sit down and give me that. Jane, Mulligan here. Over.
Go ahead, Mulligan. Over.
We got Wheeler and Rose here. Wheeler's drunk or hopped up on something. Speaking of which, that Fed had a pretty distinctive whiff of eau de scotch about him, you know what I mean. Over.
I don't have anything on that, Deputy Mulligan. Over.
Well, whatever. Anyway, Rose is just being plain weird here. You better get Doc in to take a look at both. Over.
Gotcha. You better get them here quickly. The Fed's gonna want to interview Wheeler. Over.
Oh, yeah, I bet he does. Looks like they have a lot in common. Mulligan out.
I could see the lights at the radio station in the distance. I imagine that the broadcast tower in the distance was part of the local radio station. Main seemed like a decent guy. Perhaps he could give me directions to the coal mine. Unnatural shadows clung to the gate. The darkness that was after me was trying to stop me. I wouldn't get through without a light. There was no power to the searchlight. It took me a moment to recognize the flashbang grenades. They were an ideal weapon for my situation.
FM with Pat Main.
It's Milt Peabody, Pat.
What's on your mind, Milt?
Well, I live near the trailer park, Pat, and there's a big ruckus going on over there.
Well, that's just up the road from me, too. What's going on, do you know?
I don't know, but there's a bunch of police cars there, lots of sirens, a helicopter buzzing around, and I think I heard some gunshots.
Gunshots?
Yes, sir, like from a pistol. Can you find out what's going on? Because it's just next door and they're popping off guns there.
They're still shooting?
No, it was maybe 10, 15 minutes ago. It sounds serious, Pat. I'm telling you, it don't sound like no party.
Well, I'm certainly going to give the station a call, Milt.
Okay.
You'll hear it here as soon as I hear from them.
Okay, thanks.
hope Maine could lend me a car to get to the coal mine.
Why, hello, Lorna. What do you have for us?
Well, I just don't see why the cops bothered with the trailer park.
What do you mean?
It's a trailer park. Of course you're going to have trouble in a place like that. I mean, what do you expect? The sheriff should be helping us normal citizens instead of wasting resources on those people.
Well...
Let the trash sort themselves out. I'm sorry, but my granddaddy settled in Bright Falls in 1911.
Well, thank you very much for that compassionate viewpoint, Lorna.
How can I be sure?
I had no idea how to get to the coal mine. Maine would know. And I had a feeling I wouldn't get a chance to ask anyone else anytime soon.
Oh, here's a little surprise. The famous writer Alan Wake just walked in, folks. I'm gonna see if I can talk him into an interview.
Come on in, Mr. Wake. It looks like Mr. Wake is going to need a moment before we can talk, so let me give you a little background while he prepares himself. You've all heard the name, of course. Alan Wake is the author of a very successful series of Alex Casey crime novels. He's changed gears, though. He's now working on a horror story. Now, you probably know that Mr. Wake is a somewhat controversial figure. Had a few ugly encounters with the paparazzi in recent years, although, speaking for myself, it's hard to blame him for that. Regular listeners will remember that I met him on the ferry last week. He's avoided the spotlight pretty well, but here he is, taking some time out of his vacation to talk to us.
How can I be sure?
I'm so glad you could find the time to do this, Mr. Wake.
Nowhere to run now, Dan Brown! You back away from me! Don't hurt!
Whoa. Everyone calm down. Put the gun down. We're all friends here, right?
Cool your jets, Nightingale. We got him.
Jesus Christ!
What the hell's the matter with you? There's a civilian in there!
Fallen off so many cliffs it was ridiculous. That's what you get for naming a book The Sudden Stop. It was probably good I hadn't had the chance to tell Maine where I was going. I'd have to lose the cops and find my own way to the mine. Nightingale stared through the broken studio window into the dark woods. He turned around, started to walk out, but Maine grabbed his arm. Young man, you almost shot me. You don't shoot off rounds at people like that. What's the matter with you? Nightingale shook his arm free, marched out, his cheeks burned with rage and humiliation. Danny had stepped out, but what stumbled back in was something else. Something alien. A monster. Walter tried to kill it, first with his fists, then a chair. It wouldn't die. Instead, it kept coming, unaffected by the beating it had taken. After Walter managed to kick it down the cellar stairs, fear took over. He ran, got behind the wheel, gunned the engine. The booze wouldn't make him forget, but he knew he had to try.
Hello?
The most stubborn man I've ever met.
Alice? Alice?
Alan. Alan. I'm so afraid. It keeps me in the dark. Please help me. I look at you, Alan, and it's not you. Something else. Looking out from behind your eyes.
Alice, I'm here.
I'm so alone here. It's all gonna go to hell. You need to be careful. Cooperate.
The connection had been terrible, but that wasn't the only thing that hadn't been right with the call. She sounded wrong somehow, but she had called me. The pipe wrenched itself loose from the bridge's steel framework. Wrapped in darkness, it floated in midair, twitching. For a moment, I didn't understand what I was looking at. The heavy object lurched at me with impossible force. I threw myself out of the way, but just barely. When I turned my flashlight on it, it shook in a dark rage before it flew at me again. I could see a railway bridge up ahead and a warehouse of some sort on the opposite shore. I hoped I could find a car from there.
Thank you.
slammed the door shut right in his smug face. He pleaded for me to open the door. True to form, the asshole actually thought I would obey. I had no sympathy left, no guilt either, not for him. I took a moment to savor the scream. I bet I had a smile on my face. It was all that I had time for. The dark presence was inside the lodge with me. As a teenager, just starting to get interested in writing, Stephen King had been a source of inspiration to me. I thought about all the inanimate objects that had come to life in his books. No one is safe in a good horror story, certainly not the protagonist. That's what makes them fun. This was anything but. The darkness could possess anything, and it was getting closer.
Shut and such quests always bear fruit. Night springs.
The darkness surged towards me, sucking everything loose from the ground into its depths, tugging at my clothes. I saw the flare the kidnapper had dropped and threw myself towards it just as I felt my feet leave the ground. The darkness embraced me with the force of a tornado. Somehow I managed to light the flare. The darkness roared and cast me away. I fell toward the dark waters of the lake far below.